Good evening, everyone. I'd like to call to order the regularly scheduled Planning Commission meeting for December 8th, 2015. I see that we have one regular member missing from the commission, so I'd like to appoint one of the alternates. Ron, would you be the designated alternate to seat as a regular member?
Yep.
So, Ron LaCandro. Also like
junior.
To junior.
Yes.
Also like to introduce two new members of the commission, Holly Bem and Aaron Levitt Smith. Were elected in this past cycle, and I assume you were both sworn in?
Yes, yesterday.
Okay, so everything's on the up and up.
And Elizabeth as alternate.
Oh, and Elizabeth Burt as an alternate as well, yep. Thank you. The next item on the agenda is election of officers. as it turned out in the election, the secretary from the last cycle was not reelected, so there is currently a vacancy. And I would ask if any of the regular members would like to make a motion to for a candidate for secretary.
I'd like to nominate Robert.
Okay, so Holly nominated Robert Kulikowski.
Can I ask you a question mm-hmm. before we begin? I'd like to just get a grasp, because I'm new. This is my first day as an elected official. I'm trying to understand what the rush was at the last meeting to elect a chair before the new members convened.
Mm-hmm. The main purpose was to provide a sense of continuity for the leadership of the commission.
And that could not be accomplished by the people who are convened here today?
It could have, but the commission chose to take that action during the last meeting.
If these were appointed positions, that would make sense. The person with the power to appoint would want to have to ensure the continuity, especially if they were leaving. But as we are elected officials, it's almost as though it's a slap in the face of the Simsbury voters that this was done with people who would, half the people who voted aren't on the new commission.
Jamie?
Mr. Chairman, just if I may, you have a motion,
okay.
A motion. There was no second, we're not in a discussion mode yet.
Oh, okay,
so,
sorry
to correct, but again, you have a motion. I just asked Mike if he heard a second. I did not either.
Mm-hmm. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Thank you.
Is there any discussion?
Well, I guess my discussion was germane to the task before the motion. But so
I think the motion on the table, it pertains to the election of a secretary of the commission. Since the agenda has an item for election of officers, it would be possible for someone at this point or after the election of the secretary to make a motion to nominate someone for chairman.
Because it's been on the agenda at least, now it's three, except.
Yeah, Phil's right, you could do that.
So, do we have any discussion about the nomination for secretary? Personally, I think Bob will do a great job. He's been with the commission for a number of years, is in tune with the protocol. So I have my support's behind him. Any other comments? Okay. All in favor of electing Robert Kulikowski as Secretary of the Planning Commission, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Any no votes? Okay, so it's unanimous, Janice. Congratulations, Bob.
Thank you.
Is there any other election of official business that needs to be discussed?
Well, if we were to do a do-over for chair, I would nominate Bill, and the results would be the same. But just know that that would have been a nice thing to do to wait. But it's not necessary, I think. It's my opinion.
Yep, you made that clear at the last meeting, Alan. And
I'm not going to do it again.
Yep. Okay. Thank you. Okay, next on the agenda, a public hearing. Application number 1503 of Christian Alford, P.E., Alford Associates, Incorporated, agent Norma D. Duschenek, and I apologize if I, that's okay, owner, requesting a resubdivision of the property located at 25 Holcomb Street, Assessor's Map D05, Block 301, Lot 007, to create three lots, Zone R80. So this, I will open up the public hearing. So if the applicant could make his presentation, and then we'll have the opportunity for the commission to ask questions. Staff will support us, could also ask questions. And then if members of the public wish to make a comment, please come to the podium and state your name and your address for the record.
Good evening. For the record, my name is Wilson Alford, Jr. I registered as a professional engineer and land surveyor. Our office is in Windsor. Just as a clarification, the applicant is Chris Alford. He's also with the firm and is my son. I'm here on behalf of the Duschenek family. The front row is generally friends and family of the Duschenek family. The property is on the south side of Holcomb Street. Is this satisfactory for the, if everyone can see it, except for the woman who's sitting there?
Yeah, that's right.
In the corner. Usually there's no place you can put a board where everybody can see it. So, to get you oriented, Holcomb Street is on the bottom of the sheet. North is generally sort of in this direction. The property is outlined in black. And the subdivision is the existing house and outbuildings that are located here. There are two additional proposed home lots that are here for a total of three lots. We wanted a soil testing on the property with the Farmington Valley Health District. So there should be a letter in the file from the Farmington Valley Health District that says that the soils are satisfactory for septic systems. We've been to the wetlands, or the Conservation Commission, gotten a wetlands permit for them, and are now here to ask for a subdivision of the property. One of the questions or concerns that was addressed in the planner's memo was the location or type of open space. We have been provided to the Conservation Commission and showed a piece of open space, which is at the rear of the property. There are public lands that the state owns on both sides of the property, and we are proposing to have the open space as shown in brown. The area meets the requirement of four open space, both in total area and composition of uplands and wetlands. We feel it's an appropriate piece of open space because there are open spaces on both sides of it. We would propose to have a conservation easement on it, and the conservation easement would take, and though the fee ownership would stay with a larger parcel, that there'd be a conservation easement. So in essence, we have a steward who would be on place to monitor if it were given to the town. The town probably does not want a piece of property which is sitting out in the middle and is isolated, but by putting a conservation easement on it and being owned by the individuals here, there's an in-place steward for the property to maintain
an observance of the piece of property and to supervise whether anything happens to it. The conservation easement would keep people from cutting the trees and doing whatever they would want to do to the piece of property, and it would be basically an extension of the open, spaces for the open properties that are the state. So we feel that it'd be an appropriate use of conservation easement on the piece of property. The property would be conserved, and there'd be a steward for the property who would protect the property from anybody else dealing with it. We also obviously have these two people who would be able to see if something was there, but by having it as a conservation easement, the owner of this lot would have a better interest if somebody else were to do something to the property. So the lot meets the regulations. The health district has reviewed it, and we would ask for an approval of it.
And I'd be happy to answer any questions.
The letter from the Fountain Valley Health District does mention that soil testing was performed.
Yes.
But the words they use, and I'll read it, this is based on those plans and soil testing. I assume the plans were prepared by you.
Yes.
The soil testing was done by you.
Yes.
So the Farmington Valley Health District says it appears that the proposed lots are capable of supporting septic systems.
Mm-hmm.
Why wouldn't they say that the soils are sufficient to support the septic systems?
This is similar to the letter that they write all the time. They're satisfied that they would support a septic system. The final design of it would be done after the subdivision.
Jamie or Mike, does that cause you any concern?
I can just take the brief proposal.
Okay.
The usual thing is that if we submit something to them and they don't like a lot, they usually very specifically will say the same type of language and then say, but lot number 14 does not satisfy it, and further testing would have to be done.
Mm-hmm.
And so that there usually is no question that if something does not make it, I think it's probably that, it's dirt. You dig some holes, you look at the piece of property, and based on what we've done, they appear to satisfy the regulations. We've done enough so that they should be satisfied with it. I don't think anybody can say anything 100% about anything. And it's the only thing I can say. This is normal.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, what the language typically refers to is the fact that the test pits that were dug on the site meet the minimum health code with regards to siting a residential unit as displayed on the site. But they use, we'll say, general language because ultimately an actual permit has to be applied for based on the actual house versus a schematic.
Okay.
And that will determine the minimum length leaching system. But they're saying at least what they've seen to date and the test pit data supports development on the site in a conceptual form. Final permit to be issued, could be a 5-bedroom house. It may not support a 5-bedroom house, but it may support a 3-bedroom house.
So in that instance where they had to, where maybe didn't meet the final design criteria, they may have to go back and modify the subdivision in order to be able to support it with additional area or?
In most instances, they would not come back to the Planning Commission for subdivision approval unless there was something associated with a constraint. If there was an easement that they couldn't move something. In some instances, they're required to go back to the Conservation Commission because they need to modify their wetlands permit because the minimum length leaching system got larger, so they had to grade more and more could mean closer to a wetland. But in most instances, they would not be back before you because they chose to do a 5-bedroom house versus a 3-bedroom house.
Okay.
I think it, I don't know whether it's still a question or not, but the next sentence says soil testing is also performed in these to ensure sufficient future septic reserve for that house. So,
does anyone have any comments on the proposed open space that's been described? If the subdivision regulations allow for three different types of considerations, Jamie?
Yeah. Mr. Chairman, with regards to your regulations, it's at the discretion of the commission. It's the commission's decision. The applicant can make a proposal to you. You got a recommendation from the Conservation Commission. But it is the commission's sole discretion to choose what avenue you choose to take.
Right.
I want to say there are multiple avenues associated with it. There is the nothing avenue. You are not required to do anything associated with the receipt of open space or fee removal. There is the dedication of land up to a percentage of the total acreage. It is staff's opinion in this case that this does not warrant a dedication of land. And there is an easement potential. I believe, Mr. Chairman, for the record, we'd like to submit a drawing based on their subdivision plan that shows the proposed easement in red. What you will notice in blue and crosshatched is the inland wetlands that are regulated by the towns and state regulations. The majority of the easement is inside the inland wetlands. It's already protected by another regulatory agency. And if there's significant disturbance in that wetlands, it's regulated at the federal level through the Army Corps of Engineers if it's in excess of 5,000 square feet. So it would be staff's opinion that this easement is already, in essence, an easement from a regulatory standpoint. And this may be the instance that a fee in lieu of open space may be warranted. The regulations call out how that fee can be assessed. In some aspects, I've dealt with commission where you go through the appraisal process as laid out in state statutes, and others, applicants, have come up with a acceptable number of the value of the land that the commission accepts as the appraised value, and the commission can take up to 10%. So in an analysis, if the property was valued at 210, and that's the land pre-development, it's not the development post-approval, it's pre-development value. If it was, for discussion purposes, 210,000, you could charge up to 10% of that. That would be $21,000. That could be divided amongst the three lots for $7,000 a piece. And that is not due on approval. It's only due upon initial transfer of title of the land. So if one lot is sold 5 years from now, that would be due and payable at closing. If something doesn't transpire for 20 years on another parcel, it's not due until 20 years from now. If the farmhouse is kept for 30 years in the family, and sold 3 years from now, it would be due and payable 3 years from now. And the way that town, I've done it in other municipalities, a caveat would be placed on the land records, noticing, encumbering the property by that value. But it's 10% of the appraised value. In some instances, the statute calls out for an appraisal process, an agreed upon appraiser. But in some instances, the applicant knows what the property may be, and it may actually, in some instances, I use the example with the Conservation Commission. I've been involved in a lot of farms that have been developed over time, and the value of the farm is significant. And I use the example of a farm being worth $1 million, and the family's only taking two lots off of it, and they're two 10-acre lots. It's always been my opinion that even if the valuation equaled $100,000 and you're taking two lots off of it, I'm not aware of any commissions who would charge $50,000 per lot as a fee of lieu of an open space. In most instances, they use a reasonable fee associated with past practice in a municipality. I wouldn't support, even if this property was worth $500,000 and the value was $50,000, I would not recommend dividing 3 by 50. I think that would be excessive from this standpoint.
Jamie, please explain again the blue crosshatched area. What's the designation?
The perimeter solid blue line is the wetlands, flagged wetlands as shown on their subdivision map. The crosshatched area is what is wet. And the good majority of their easement is inside of that regulated area. There's a second aspect. There's a, we'll call it a, I think, fuchsia, if not pink color.
Yep.
That is the area that is outside of the 100-foot upland wetlands review area. So in essence, that's the small little piece that is unregulated, but you can't get there without perhaps a permitting process. They can continue to farm and utilize the property unencumbered as an agricultural use as of right, in the same manner they're utilizing the property today, which I believe you testified in conservation, it's hay, right?
Yes.
And you brush hog. So again, there's a good use for this property to continue it in agricultural use and perhaps not encumber it. Other regulations encumber this property. I don't think there's a need for an additional layer of easements. It's well protected.
And it's bounded by state open
and
space
bounded
on
by state
two sides.
On the east side and south side.
So it's already protected.
That is
my
view.
Don't need to do it twice.
No need to do it twice.
So they can satisfy the requirement with a fee in lieu.
And again, the commission always has the option of less than 10%. Or again, you also have the option to require nothing. Whatever you would do, I would ask you to be consistent with the application. This is a division of land. So what you do on this application could be germane to what you do on another. And it's circumstances associated with the application, not with the applicant. So it's the division of the land, not the circumstances of why it's being divided.
How is it regulated, with the wetlands? I see that two of the lots that are proposed are in that region.
There is an upland review area of 100 feet. The Conservation Commission, in making their approvals, did not further encumber the property with any requirements for easements. They are, if you look at their site development plan, you'll see the, I believe, the corners of the minimum length leaching systems associated with the septic system and some grading associated with those are within the 100-foot upland review area.
Mm-hmm.
But they are proposing no activity and close association with the wetlands. So that resource will be protected, and that was the conclusion the Conservation Commission came to. And there was no intent of the applicant to, we call it in the field, lawn creep. They mentioned the fact that the property's been ag, it's been ag, and in their mind, and please correct me because you're here this evening, that buffer close to the wetlands, in essence, would not be a state-like setting for lawn. It's kind of fairway and rough and on golf course, and it would remain rough. But again, it would be maintained, but not maintained to a fairway standard.
The fee itself would be determined at a later date?
The fee needs to be determined by the commission. It does not have to be determined during the hearing process, but
that's
you would need to do it prior to action. But we have some new members. Mr. Chairman, if I can go over procedure.
Yep.
In Connecticut, once you open a public hearing, you have 35 days to close that hearing. The applicant can consent to extensions of the entire process up to 65 days. In essence, you have a month to close a hearing, and you could hold it open for 3 months. If the applicant consents to it. If they don't consent to any extensions, you need to close the hearing. Once the hearing closes, your decision needs to be based on the application and the information contained within the public hearing process. You always have access to staff, but once the hearing closes, if you're deliberating fee in lieu of open space, and say, well, before we set a number, I want to check with the applicant, you don't have access to the applicant. So if they have any insight to a fee or conservation or dedication, the public hearing is the appropriate time for them to come. Once that hearing closes, that opportunity to hold that discussion with the applicant is no longer available to you. Alternate is not seated, Mr. Chairman.
I think she can ask a question.
That's been your practice?
That's a little controversial. It depends on the commission. We've been given a couple different opinions.
May I weigh in? And I'm weighing in as a planner, I'm not your legal counsel. It has always been my understanding that an applicant has the right to be judged by the seated members of the commission. There are six members to this commission. The exception to that would be if there is a public hearing being held, that a commission member who is not seated may ask a question associated with the application but not state an opinion. And the reason to the exception of a public hearing is if the public hearing closes and you don't make a decision tonight, and a regular member doesn't show up next meeting, and Elizabeth is seated, correct, Elizabeth? Is seated. You don't want her to not vote because she couldn't ask her question tonight. But if it was not a public hearing process and just a regular site plan review or subdivision review, it's the commission who is seated who participates. And that may be consistent with what you've been advised in the past or slightly different. But I mean, my counsel for many years has been Attorney Mike Siska for 26 years.
Okay, so after hearing that, Elizabeth, do you still have a question that you think you want to ask?
Yes.
Okay.
Maybe, I don't know, maybe it's a clarification, but once the hearing is closed, the commission can get no further input from the applicant, but can it seek input from experts?
You can seek input from your staff.
Only from the staff.
From staff. And staff has to base their information based on the record. We can't pull information from outside of the record. So if you wanted tax information that needs to come in during the public hearing process, I would not be comfortable going after the hearing closed and providing you a tax evaluation from the assessor. In my view, it would need to come in during the process. So if you wanted additional information with regards to the appraised value from an assessment standpoint, I would recommend to keep the hearing.
Okay.
And you meet every 2 weeks, so
yeah.
Every 2 weeks.
For sure. So would the applicant be willing to discuss fee in lieu of open space?
There was a discussion of $2,500 a lot that was brought up. We would prefer this.
You would prefer that?
For sure. The reason being, you could discard the information if you want. The purpose of the subdivision is because the owner of the property is in a nursing home. That, whatever the fee is, comes out of, you know, the monthly stipend towards the nursing home. And I understand, that shouldn't be one of your considerations because you're dealing with a piece of property, but, that's the fact of life. And you can, take that for what it is. We would prefer this.
I had to clarify, I'm sorry. She lives there. We have a live-in aid.
Okay.
That's $6,000 a month just to keep my grandmother there. She's not in a home, I'm sorry.
Good.
Thought you should.
Okay. Not pertinent to this discussion.
That's a correction.
Can I ask you a question?
That's why we prefer this action.
Yeah. As our staff just mentioned, that fee is not payable until the title is changed.
Correct.
Sold. So
but the intention is that the purpose we're subdividing the property is so that we can sell lots and generate money to maintain what's happening. So it would be something, if you approved it tonight and they could sell the property tomorrow morning, they would be selling the property tomorrow morning. So that's, otherwise we wouldn't be going through this process. We prefer this. I think it's a reasonable
know, it does have open space, it's adding to open space. That used to be one of the buzzwords of, you know, where you locate open space. There are wetlands which are associated with a piece of property. The wetlands doesn't prohibit you from doing it. We're not going to go build a house there, but we can do other things out there, cutting trees and plowing, et cetera. If it's a conservation easement, it would be left in its natural state and would add to the overall, you know, ecology of the area. I think that would be reasonable. There's discussion in there of $2,500 a lot. It's the commission's decision.
Do we have to point out our
preference and our reasons for it?
Not at this point.
I don't think we do. No appraisal of the property.
No.
Where'd the $2,500 come from?
That's understandable.
Mr. Chairman, if I may, there is a provision contained within the regulations that allows the applicant to request an alternative to the appraisal process, which is contained in Appendix 2 of your regulations and referenced in Section 15B 5. That says, see also fee in lieu of open space, FILO amendment, Appendix 2 of these regulations, an alternative payment in process, which does allow someone to request an assessment of $2,500 per lot. And in this case would be a total of $7,500. I think in this case, just understand it would be substantially less than you're also allowed to do by law. Mm-hmm. But again, we do not have an appraisal process. In some instances, applicants feel very comfortable with a number that the commission can accept because the statute says you have to hire an appraiser. The appraiser has to be agreed on by the town, and usually the appraisal firm is a much more conservative one, perhaps, than what the applicant wants to use. And that takes time, and sometimes time is very important to the applicant. And the applicant, as well as commission members, usually have a good sense of the value of things. But the statute does clearly say appraisal.
Okay, changing the subject just a little bit. This application for a re-subdivision still leaves an appreciable amount of property in one parcel. Is there anything that would prevent another re-subdivision of that remaining large parcel? Protected lands or anything else?
I don't know whether there's enough frontage or not. I think that probably there's not enough frontage for it to do it. The wetlands, you can do certain things in, but probably the just full hog built houses, you can't. It looks like we did, you know, there's not enough frontage to have another lot there.
Well, a road could be constructed.
I would not like to ask the Wetlands Commission if we could build a road for that. I mean, my usual logic with the wetlands is that if you have, you know, 1,000 acres of good land and you've got to cross a 10-foot strip of wetlands to get to it from the road, you probably get permission to get to the 1,000 acres. If you have 1 acre out in the back and you've got to cross 300 feet of wetlands to get to it, they, you know, you're probably not going to get permission to do that.
Any other questions from commissioners, comments? I'll open it up to members of the public if anyone would like to make a statement, ask a question. Please come to the podium and state your name and address, please.
Good evening. First time in one of these. My name is Neely Rodriguez. I'm here with my wife, Kathy. I live in 12 Baldwin. My only concern with the subdivisions, I know some proposed sizes of homes. I believe the area has an equitable value currently. Too much home, not enough home. Is there any restrictions that would limit the minimum size of the home or the maximum size of, to keep prices in that area comparable? My concern as a homeowner, existing homeowner, is that, you know, too much house, not enough house could ruin the property value of my house.
Mr. Chairman, I'm not aware of any minimum standards associated with residential home size. And nor am I aware of any ability of a planning commission to condition approval requiring a certain type and or size of home be constructed on the site.
There is some control with the buildable square.
Right. Yes. The buildable area is about all.
The only control you potentially have is impervious surface. Buildable square is for determining lot suitability. You do not have to build within the buildable square.
But you can't exceed the buildable square.
You could exceed the buildable square if you did not exceed the impervious area.
But in any case, that would just set a plan area. It wouldn't set number of stories or anything like that. So I think the...
So if they were limited to, on a impervious cover of 2,000 square feet, and the height requirement was 35 feet in the zone, they could do a three-story house and build a 6,000 square foot house.
Sure.
You're not going to get the guarantee you're looking for.
No, I guess no. It's zoned for a single-family home.
Right. Okay. Right, I believe it's an R80 zone.
Yes.
So roughly 2 acres. And I think the plans show that pretty much to the decimal point. Any other questions? Please come up to the podium.
Yes, sir. My name is Charles Kaler. I live next door at 29 Holcomb Street, right here. And one question that I have is the frontage of the existing lot. I don't think we got the answer on the frontage piece of it, if it can be subdivided in the future, is what I'm wondering. I don't think it's possible or feasible to put lots back here, and I don't think that's the Deschanics' intention at all here, but I'm just wondering if this parcel can be subdivided anymore.
Do we have an idea what the frontage is there?
Mr. Chairman, just doing a quick analysis, there's a linear dimension of 200.45 feet and another dimension of 116,669. Just rounding off 316 feet, that would not be enough for two frontage lots, but there's a regulatory process, and someone could potentially apply for a front lot and a rear lot without doing a considerable analysis. That's something staff couldn't determine this evening.
Can't rule it out.
Okay. You answered my question. What other questions do I have? So most of this, when I look at the diagram, most of it seems to be wetland back there. Am I correct? Okay. There was a site plan also for houses on there as well. Do we have an idea of what size houses are planned for the two lots?
It's on the other side.
Does that reflect the square footage of the houses on there?
Should I answer? I don't want to get into it.
Not at all. This is information from me. Yeah.
But the houses that are shown are generally the sizes of, you know, what could be typical houses that were built. As it was discussed before, there are no guarantees as to how big the house or how small the house is going to be.
Okay.
I mean, the only reliance you have is they would like to get as much money as possible, and if somebody pays a lot of money for the lots, they're not going to build a small house.
Thank you.
They're going to look at the neighborhood and build something that's, you know, commensurate.
Great. Okay. I think that's all the questions I have. The one thing that I didn't realize was about the easement that you were going to create at the rear of the property, the conservation easement, and I'm just wondering about regulations for use of that for the homeowner in the future, or for your family. Are you able to hunt or do anything on the easement conservation piece of it?
We have no proposed easement language from the applicant.
All right.
Jamie, something that's typically proposed by the applicant, or would be something the town would propose?
In other municipalities that I've worked in, we usually have a sample. I do have a sample available from work over the years that has been vetted by other legal counsels. They have not been asked to provide that to the applicant. It's something we could provide to the applicant. But basically, it's a no-cut, no-disturb easement that has a section for exceptions. And if we were in a forested scenario that was perhaps a wetlands, it would be a no-cut, no-disturb, boots on the ground only, with the exception to remove storm-related damage or deadfall. But there are always provisions in there for someone to come in and modify that easement. And an example of suppose there was storm damage and sunlight got to below the canopy and automobile of a multi-flora came into that setting and they wanted permission to go in and remove the invasives. Those are exceptions we can write into that language. But in this instance, it's going to be, I think if I proposed an easement, it's going to be an easement with a lot of exceptions. I have the ability to maintain it as agriculture. I'm going to be able to plow it, till it, mow it, raise cattle. So the only thing, I'm not sure what it would do to protect. Not build a structure. Try and get a permit to build a structure in the middle of the wetlands. Again, I'll stick to what I said before. It's redundant. That area is already protected by other regulatory aspects contained within the state or at the federal level. I'm a strong believer in easements and keeping land with the landowner. I really do not believe you need an easement here. The easement is going to be, the exceptions are going to even weaken the easement. The easement will basically, you can do what you want with the property other than building a structure. Already done.
In terms of consistency, mm-hmm. when the town has seen similar situations, I know we've used fee in lieu of in the past. It seems to me we need to be
the concept consistent. Of fee in lieu of is instead of taking small pieces all over town,
right.
you use the fee in lieu of to leverage either existing town funds or state funds to acquire a more appropriate piece and better set. I mean, I have maps in municipalities I've worked in. There are all these little green spots all over the town. And a lot of municipalities who've collected over $250,000 in fee and lieu of open space and then went and acquired open space.
That's usable by the residents.
Yeah, and everybody should understand, we have new members. The fee and lieu of open space contains a lockbox. So it does not go into the general fund. It's targeted. It can be used for the acquisition of open space or the improvement of open space for municipal property. So it doesn't go to underwrite the mill rate. Mm-hmm. It is a targeted fund and in essence has a lockbox on it for a specific purpose. So it doesn't go to buy a new vehicle for the planning department. It doesn't go to underwrite salaries for another department. It has a targeted purpose.
And again, the fee isn't due until
it's not
closing.
Due until transfer of title.
Can I ask a question since I'm one of the newer members? How often do these fees, do these things get put in place for this kind of thing? I mean, is it...
How often?
Yeah.
It depends on the level of activity. I can only give you experience from where I've been. And maybe this will be a good analogy for the commission. If you went back 20 years and looked at all of the lots that were created, maybe 500, and you were able to collect 5,000 times 500, how much money would you have? Quite a bit. So it's a long-term venture. It's not a short-term, three lots, if it was $2,500 or a higher value, not going to go out and be able to buy something immediately, but it's incremental. It's this one, the next one, and then 100 lots at a value, all of a sudden is $500,000. $500,000 can leverage state funds readily.
You may be wrong, but I think Aaron's trying to find out how often does this come up and how often do we have a fee in lieu?
With municipalities I've worked for, every subdivision application.
It's not uncommon.
In the past municipalities I've worked for, which I've worked for the town of Lisbon for the past 20 years, the town of Pomfret for the past 26, and the town of Sterling for the past 26, I want to say for well over 10 years, fee in lieu of open space is their primary avenue in those municipalities. Because, again, they took the stance of not acquiring small pieces. They do acquire when it makes sense. They also do, we'll say, a reduction of fee in a combination, in easements granted. A lot of times they have view sheds or corridors, or they want to protect the front 75 feet of a parcel and make sure development occurs well beyond the setback on a scenic highway. And they'll reduce the fee in lieu of open space in a combined. Your regulations allow you to do a combination.
Aaron, I'll answer your question directly. I've been on the commission 6 years. There has been no fee in lieu of for any subdivision in that time. Okay, it's been discussed, but it has not happened.
And what were the reasons for not doing that?
We were able to include open space transferred to the town,
okay,
or conservation easements. Okay, and I don't remember any applications where we had no consideration for open space either. Okay.
And to expand upon that, I haven't been involved in an application in a very, very long time where nothing, the no option was exercised. It's always been something.
Now, the town, though, now is starting to discuss the inventory of open space,
mm-hmm,
that it owns. I'm not going to pass judgment on whether the town believes it's a burden or a positive thing, just to say that there are discussions going on. Where I would not be in favor of transferring anything like this to the town because of its lack of accessibility for maintenance and ongoing activities. Certainly I'm very open to the fee in lieu of option. The conservation easement, it seems to be kind of a double dip based on the other overlying regulations. So that's kind of where I'm thinking right now.
The town wouldn't want that, in my opinion, from what I hear people say. It's an orphan piece of property that nobody can get at, nobody can use, and the town has to pay to maintain it. So we don't want it. So these are alternatives.
Just a final thought. Living next to the Deshanics, I really enjoyed meeting your father. He was a good person to the town of Simsbury.
Thank you.
And I wish you, your family, well with the project.
Thank you.
Okay? And thank you for your volunteerism.
Any other comments?
And I think the father would approve of what they're doing here too, for what it's worth.
Randall Kane, live on 11 White Oak Lane in Simsbury. Again, I'd like to reiterate what he just said about the grandfather. He was a Simsbury guy. I know it doesn't mean anything in your voting. Volunteer fireman for 50 years. And the proceeds, again, are going towards the grandmother who has lived in that house for 50 years. And I just think that if there was a precedent before of no fee, that there still should be no fee. Whether you want to take the open space, or easement or whatever you call it, that'd be fine. But if you don't. You have three options. And from what I heard tonight was just fee, fee, fee. I didn't hear about really the other options. That's just my opinion. Thank you.
Please come up.
My name is Beth Olson, and I live at 40 Holcomb Street. And I know Mr. Deshanic. He's a very wonderful man. And I'm in support of their project. Thank you.
Randy, just to make it clear.
Yep.
There's really four options.
Okay.
One is doing nothing.
Okay.
Okay?
Sure.
Then there's the transfer to the town.
Yep.
Conservation easement or fee in lieu of.
Right.
I'm Tammy O'Brien. I live on 12 Sims Croft Place, and I've known the Duchenics and Meredith and her family for years, and I'm also in favor of the project. So.
Thank you. Any other questions? Okay, so in light of the uncertainty around the open space aspects of this, I'd like to continue the public hearing.
Mr. Chairman, at least can I clarify one thing?
Sure.
Before you go there. When I was talking about a conservation easement, I was not talking about one with the exceptions in it. I was talking about one which was sort of the one which was, you can go in and clear, you know, windfall, and you can walk on a piece of property, but that's all you can do on a piece of property. So it would be protected from, you know, the normal conservation of the piece of property, and why the Conservation Commission, I think, was in favor of it, is because of the ecological value of it, whether residents could use it or not. They were in favor of it because of the ecological value of connecting it with other open spaces. And I did not picture exceptions in my mind. I pictured, you know, that, you know, you could cut deadfall and you could walk on a piece of property, and that's what the conservation easement would allow. So it basically would protect the piece of property. So when I was trying to describe as contrasting versus clear cutting, that would destroy, you know, some of the ecological value of having it near the other open spaces that were there. So that, you know, there is the, you know, the planning value of having people to be able to use it, but there's also the value that the Conservation Commission recognized of having it adjacent to other open spaces and that value that it does have.
Would you be able to prepare a draft conservation easement?
I probably would ask the planner to give me his and present that to
you. I was going to see who was going to blink first.
Yeah.
I mean,
staff can do that.
Yeah, I mean, whatever we prepare is going to be given to the staff. The staff is going to have the town attorney look at it, mm-hmm. and it's going to end up looking quite a bit like what is already yeah. sitting.
So, Jamie, there have been several instances where conservation easements have been a condition of the approval. Mm-hmm. So there should be several examples to draw from previous applications. Okay, so I'll ask that at the next meeting.
Provide
that. Yeah, you'll have a draft, and maybe you can share it with the applicant prior to the meeting.
I can perhaps share it tomorrow.
Thank you.
Okay.
And hopefully it's strict enough. We have no qualms about protecting the property, and I think it's an appropriate place for, you know, because of the adjacent open spaces. But.
Yep. Okay. Any other comments?
I don't think so. Thank you.
Okay, so we'll continue the public hearing, at least until the next Planning Commission meeting on December 22nd. And.
Time and place, Mr. Chairman?
It'll be at 7 o'clock here in the main meeting room, Town Hall.
Thank
and
you.
So that's a regularly scheduled meeting. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, back to the agenda. Okay, discussion of possible action on any agenda item. I think we've taken all the action we can tonight. Approval of minutes of November 10th. Mr. Secretary, would you walk us through that, please?
Secretary, I ask everyone to look at the minutes. Have you received an email? Review it. Any changes on page one?
Just
Any changes to page one? Bill Carter?
Yeah.
No. Page two?
On the line 119.
They're not quite there. No, yeah. Holly or Holly?
Oh, that's it. I'm sorry. That's page three.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, there it is.
Nothing on page two? Hearing none. Page
yeah,
three.
I just have a question. No? Janice, do you know if the meeting schedule has been amended? We had the June.
We had a June problem.
Chair should have amended it and filed.
Okay.
So yes, that should with the changes as noted by the commission.
Okay.
And I can confirm that with you tomorrow, Mr. Chair.
Okay, just drop me a note.
Yep.
Page three.
Okay. I have a question on line 19. It looks like there's an omission. The planning and zoning chair's opinions were that the commissions should remain separate, but there's no rationale for that opinion. Was there no discussion on it?
No.
No, there was just a statement.
They just reported to what they said to the, I think we're talking about the charter commission.
Right. Mm-hmm. I mean, as a member of the group that recommended that and our newly elected secretary, there was no discussion. That's not how we do it.
Who presented that?
FERC
did.
FERC merely reported that he and the chairman, if I remember right, of zoning,
mm-hmm.
talked to charter revision, and neither had a strong opinion either way.
But said the opinions were that the commissions should remain separate, so that is a strong opinion. And
I don't think that's what
okay. Am I wrong,
Bob? No, you're absolutely right, Alan. The FERC reported out that it spoke to the him and Mr. Pomeroy spoke with the Charter Revision Commission, and that they had expressed their feelings that the two commissions remain separate.
Is that what they said?
So they had a strong opinion, but no rationale behind it that they gave?
Not presented to this commission.
Not presented to this commission.
They weren't sent by this commission to give an opinion. They went as individuals.
Mm-hmm.
They happen to be chairs, as you can do too.
You can do
that as well.
Yeah, Ferg Jansen was just recounting the conversation he had with the Charter Revision Committee.
And the Charter Revision Committee was under the impression that these opinions had never been discussed in those particular commissions.
That wasn't discussed in the meeting.
Okay.
It had not been discussed on this commission. No. That's a personal opinion.
This is a real hierarchical, you know, one guy speaks for everyone.
Yeah, you can go too. They have a public audience.
You can do anything you want, which is great. Any changes on page three?
No, but I do have a question. Is Commissioner Pearl going to be replaced?
The ruling is such.
He's resigned yet.
No, he has not resigned, and he can continue to serve on both the Land Use Committee and the Board of Finance. Mm-hmm. Okay, so I don't know what the plan is at this point.
I can just clarify what occurred at the zoning meeting if you would like. Mm-hmm. There was a discussion on election of officers, and then there was a motion to table action on the election of officers until all six regular members were present. That was seconded and voted on unanimously. Because we do not have a resignation of the existing chair.
For the zoning commission.
For zoning.
Right. What you're saying is the last zoning commission meeting didn't have six regular members?
Yes.
They're asking whether
Kevin Crowe
has resigned.
So just to clarify, Kevin, we asked an opinion of Bob DiCrescenzo whether both Bob Pomeroy on zoning commission and Kevin Crowe can serve on both Land Use Commission and Board of Finance. Nothing in state statute prohibits them from serving on both commissions if they want to, you know, serve that board, you know, that time period for both. We have not received, at least I'm not aware of, a letter of resignation filed with the town clerk from Mr. Krell. So he is still on the commission until he resigns.
Yeah.
And he has to do that if he's going to resign in writing to the town clerk.
Mm-hmm.
one would hope that if he doesn't resign, he attends meetings. That would be nice.
That would be my expectation.
Well, let the word go forth.
Yep.
We'd like Kevin to come.
Okay, can we finish? Can we finish the minutes? Ending on page 4. Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion to accept the minutes.
So moved.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Hearing a second. Any discussion? Take a vote. All in favor of accepting the minutes of regular meeting in November 10th, 2015?
Without, without amendment.
Without amendment.
Aye.
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 All opposed? Abstentions?
Me.
Okay, Holly.
Holly.
I wasn't here, so.
Yep. You weren't here.
Oh,
okay. So, Aaron, you want to change your vote?
I do. I'll abstain.
Abstain.
Okay, how many votes?
So, Ron, did you?
I was an aye.
1, 2, 3, 4.
We're good.
Yep.
Okay. Yeah. So you get that, Janet?
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Okay. So, just a point of order, Aaron. That question you had probably would have been better asked right here, where I say, "Is there any new business on the commission? Any old business to be addressed?" Okay, we did discuss a little bit prior to the meeting whether we should have the December 22nd meeting or not, but based on the trends, you know, what transpired today, we will go on with the regularly scheduled meeting. I understand it's in the holiday season and everything, but we have an obligation to the applicant, and we should fulfill that obligation.
This is, we can try and keep a light agenda that evening, Mr. Chairman.
Be nice.
Point of order, Mr. Chairman, I will not be here that night.
Okay.
Point of order, I will not be there.
Okay.
I will not be here. Well,
we need four regular, we need four people. See.
Right.
Yeah.
I will be here.
I'll be here.
I'll be here.
Okay.
So I'll be here.
We got four.
Thank you for letting us know.
Thank you. I'll be in Texas. I'm sorry.
Okay.
Under old business.
Yep.
We had talked about having a packet for the new members.
Oh, right. Oh, I'm sorry. That was on the
agenda.
That's on the agenda.
Sorry.
Yes.
Sorry.
Okay.
Yep. So yeah, we're discussing options. To educate new members, new members of the commission and existing members of the commission. I've submitted some ideas or my bullet items to Jamie and Mike. So I think the ball's in their court to come up with something.
Yes.
So I did have a question. If we meet as a group, is that
quorum constitutes? Got a notice.
Special meeting.
Yeah. Technically, you're supposed to record all meetings where a decision is made. So, your agenda item could be workshop,
yeah,
discussion of procedures, and list some agenda items that are pretty broad in nature, so that you're covered by your agenda. But you have to open the meeting, close the meeting, and then by adjournment.
Yep.
Over to the commission. But with regards to recording and keeping detailed minutes, it's a workshop. You're not making any decisions.
And that's been known before.
Yes.
There's been workshops.
But it is. I've been in front of some commission and say, well, it's a workshop. We can just meet. No, it's a quorum of the commission, and you're still subject to four.
Okay. But just to put it in perspective, I'm thinking that I'd like to have this done prior to the end of January.
Yeah.
Okay. But in the meantime, for the new members, there are a couple documents that are available on the town website that I would suggest that you either acquire or read. They're integral to the functioning of the Planning Commission, and that's the Plan of Conservation and Development, okay, and Subdivision Regulations.
I think we got that.
Yeah.
That was given to us in the packet. We just got sent.
Oh, okay. Good.
Yeah.
You guys did that?
Yes.
Excellent.
So, Plan of Conservation and
Development.
Okay.
We call it the POCD.
That is our document for this group.
Yeah.
which needs to be renewed, correct?
Yeah.
Yes, every 10 years.
On the website.
Which is coming up.
Yeah, they are on the website.
I think you.
2017.
Yep. Mike also mentioned the possibility of a CLEAR workshop.
Well, I need, if I may, Mr. Chairman, one of the items I was tasked on pre-day one is formulating a more formal workshop educational process, both for new members and existing members as time goes on. Because, you know, we're reading statutes, we're reading case law as it comes out, but some of you may and some of you may not. So I think you rely on us. But in making your decisions, it's very critical that you understand the global picture associated with how you act. And I think I'm absolutely excited at the fact that I'm allowed to do this for you. As we go forward, I'll work with the chairman on what we're doing first and what we're doing second. Brief, just raise a hand. How many people are very comfortable reading site plans, topography, storm drainage, and site layout?
And I've been to the CLEAR workshops, okay. And what little I know came from there.
Okay. So I'm always available as a resource, as well as anyone in my office. If you want to call me, we can do one-on-one sessions quickly. If we don't have a workshop for two more meetings, potentially, but I want to say the earliest I can do something is probably January. But if some of the new members are concerned and you want to come in one afternoon and sit down or have a chat on the phone about roles, responsibilities, I think. Elizabeth had a very poignant question tonight of, you know, I'm an alternate. Can I raise my hand and ask a question? And, thank you for allowing me to clarify that. But as a planning commission, you act primarily administratively, and that's subdivision approvals. And then subdivision approvals, if there are 10 requirements and the applicant meets those 10 requirements, you're in essence bound to approve those. It's not a matter of whether you like the architecture, like the house, like the fact there's 50 houses and you think there should be 40. They either meet the regs or they don't.
Right.
And we'll hopefully work hard as staff to position applicants to meet the regulations. And if they don't, we will report to you where they are deficient. And then you have the ability to approve, deny, or modify an application. We have some other things with the POCD. I do have a handout associated with the POCD of a tentative time frame. Your POCD expires on November 3rd, 2017. So we have less than a year.
Right, so we have a year and a half.
So we have a year and a half.
Almost 2 years.
Yeah. Almost 2 years.
But you don't necessarily have 2 years because
right.
We don't have it budgeted yet.
That's what my question was.
So we don't have it budgeted. So if I can just run through it. The POCD expires on November 3rd, 2017. So that's when it expires. But we have some statutory requirements. 65 days before your public hearing, I have to give a copy to the Regional Council of Governments for an opinion. I have to file 35 days prior with the town clerk. I have to have a digital copy available on the town's website 35 days prior to a public hearing. So you take November and you back out 2 months. So I'm already in September. You don't meet in August.
Right.
So I'm at July. I don't have a budget until this coming July. So I have 12
years.
Yeah. But I have to hold my hearings prior to July, because there's always a little bit of slippage, and I can't slip till August. I don't want to call you all in. And September makes a really tight push in October. So again, my intention is to submit a budget request this December, if not January 2017, to do a request for qualifications versus a request for proposals. If someone doesn't understand the difference, I can explain that. But doing an RFQ, I think, allows the municipality and commission some flexibility in hiring the best qualified firm and then negotiating a fee. Consultant selection in June or July of 2016, initiate the contract in July or August of 2016, and prepare the plan in 8 to 10 months. and final draft April, May 2017, public hearings in June and July, and adoption in September, and setting an effective date prior to November 7th, 2017.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, 8-10 months may seem like a long time with a POCD, but it may not, especially if you get by. It's easy if you meet twice a month and you don't have anything on your agenda and you can dedicate from 7 to 9 o'clock every night, two nights for 8 months. But all of a sudden you get 8 subdivision applications and you're intended to work on the POCD. And you're looking at the clock going, it's 10 o'clock. Who wants the motion to adjourn? We'll table the POCD discussion to the next meeting. Well, you still have those 8 applications. So we have to build some slippage into the schedule.
And there's usually workshops involved.
And there's workshops and public hearings and surveys that need to go out.
The last one took longer than you're allowed for.
Yeah. Allowed. Now, there is, before when a POCD expired, it expired. Nothing happened. A few years ago, OPM required you to make a statement on any request for financial assistance above and beyond your general assistance that a community receives that your POCD is not current. They passed newer legislation that says you have to do that with that financial request, and the fear is they're going to make two piles. So if you're going for an open space grant and you're not current, before everybody went in the same pile. So the fear is there's two piles now. Mm. Everybody who's current goes in that you qualify for additional money, and if you're not current, you go in the other pile and don't even have an opportunity for that. So that hard deadline of November 2017, I think, is a real date.
Yeah.
It's a real date. The drop dead date was actually supposed to be July 1, 2015 for any municipality that did not have a current plan. Excuse me, it was 2015. They amended the statute to give towns that weren't current to July 1st, 2016, but then I heard a requirement they had to do a sustainability plan, and not a sustainability plan, you had to do a sewer avoidance analysis. So you had to draw lines on the map of where sewer shouldn't go in your municipality. That was never required prior to a year ago. So again, it's become more critical. I think it's an important, it shouldn't just be a document that, you know, done, put on the shelf, 10 years went by, we got to do it again. It is a working, breathing document. So homework, I guess, is read through the existing one and look at that. The primary product of your POCD is your future land use map,
mm-hmm.
which is supposed to drive the decisions made by zoning when they formulate their map,
right.
or make amendments to it. So it's an important document.
And for the new members, the consultant is somebody we hire to guide us through the process.
Yes.
Give us examples and things.
Yes.
So it isn't like we just write the darn thing.
No. I have been involved in that aspect of the commission.
I've watched that process. It's
yeah.
laborious.
So if it's staff-driven, it's a two-year process.
Yeah.
You know, because there's always a lot of slippage when staff gets pulled in multiple directions. But again, if it's okay, I'll work with the chairman on prioritizing the list. I think, Bill, you did a good job coming up with a list for a good discussion, and we can categorize those into slots. I think the primary one I want to start off with is roles, responsibilities, and procedures.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah. Jamie, any other correspondence or updates from staff?
Other than I'm really excited to be here. Welcome, new members.
Interesting first meeting.
I really respect your dedication as volunteers. It's important to the democratic process, and I wish I could do more of it, but I'm usually at meetings like this.
Yeah.
And then my family sees me. You know, my wife would, I'm at 90 plus meetings a year, so. The other is family time.
Yeah.
Or Jamie, soccer time.
Jamie, one question on the POCD process. Is there any difference in involvement between the regular members and the alternate members when it comes to that process?
The way that I like to handle that is those sessions are held in a workshop format.
you know. So it's open.
So it's open to the commission, all members.
Okay.
The process of adoption goes back to more parliamentary procedures of who's seated and who can participate. But it, yeah, there's no intent, nor have I ever seen a commission go through the process where a chairman will say, you know, we're talking with our consultant, and I'm sorry, you're an alternate, you're not seated, so watch tonight.
Right.
And you can do that for the whole process. Right. And then be seated at the end to vote on it.
Right.
So we would, my recommendation would be to hold those in workshop style sessions.
Okay, Aaron?
Well, I just had a question, so I'm not clear on the clean process. Are we going to be doing meetings, trainings? I didn't get a sense of.
Yeah, we'll be having a workshop.
Okay.
Hopefully by the end of January.
If your agenda is, you're already committed to, not discussing August, you're already committed to 24 night meetings a year, you know, barring holidays and a little break in the summer. It would be my preference for you to hold those workshop sessions at an evening meeting that are targeted to your roles and responsibilities. We also have the opportunity for CLEAR to bring them in, but CLEAR, I believe, requires
15,
a commitment of 15 land use and warm bodies. So that would be done in a group setting or a group dynamic, and I think at Simsbury it's going to be a challenge to find a night that no one has a meeting for something else. But we can do that, and maybe we have to do two of them. There also will be a wonderful opportunity a little over a year from now where the Connecticut Bar Association in March, late February, early March, holds an all-day session at Wesleyan. It is led by the leading land use attorneys in Connecticut. It's 8 a.m. to 4 p.m. They do provide you with lunch, bring a lot of caffeine. but it is worthwhile, and I, you know, it's a year away. They do it every 2 years. So if you miss it, it's a 2 year wait. But
it's really good. You
and also,
the binder this thick. That you
any additional educational opportunities, we'll vet through the chair and make available to you. Mm-hmm.
Is CLEAR the one that's given by UConn?
Yes.
Okay.
Bruce Hyde will typically do the land use and or some of the CG, Connecticut General Statutes, and site plan reading. And typically a land use attorney will come in and do roles and responsibilities.
I think that's the last one.
They actually have a very good website.
We only have a few new members. Does it make sense to combine that with some other municipalities to get 15 people?
I know when I worked for the Southeastern Connecticut Council of Governments, we would host those sessions and we would invite all members of all commissions in our 22 municipalities. So I was talking to Emily at Capital Region today, and we're in the process of setting up a meeting to see if Capital Region, you know, Simsbury could be the host, where Granby's invited, Avon, Farmington's also invited, and maybe we do multiple ones.
Mm.
That's a good one.
Is anybody open to a Saturday session?
Sure.
Yeah. Look at the level of commitment.
I thought I was going to sneeze.
should we submit dates of availability at no small cost to my private business? I rescheduled an international business trip to be here today,
okay.
But I rescheduled it for January, not to interfere with the planning meeting, but I'd be really bummed to miss this opportunity. So should I submit? I don't have the dates, but it's for a week.
No, when you get it.
Yeah,
forward them to us.
Because I really would like to be part of that.
Yeah. However, if you're not part of it, I've taught the site plan part before it was CLEAR.
Mm-hmm.
So
what does CLEAR mean? What? CLEAR, what does it stand for?
You had to ask
land.
Me. Connecticut.
Land. Just make it up,
Jay. Yeah, I'm going to walk out. It's going to bug me. I say it so many times. Mike's going to Google it.
I'm going to land use education and research.
Sounds good.
And then,
I don't know
what
that's
in.
I
was going to say. But it's a
I know, I just wanted to know what the acronym stood for.
It's a throwback from the extension service associated with UConn that's been brought in-house at the university. Again, I am available to consult with if you have procedural issues between now and the next meeting or as time goes on. Please feel free to reach out to staff. I'm unavailable. Ask for additional staff. I want you to be as educated as you want to be as a commission and give you the tools in the toolbox to make good decisions on behalf of the town that are based on the land, not the applicant.
Very good. Well, before I forget, I want to thank SCTV for recording this meeting. Thanks, Bob. Any other comments, questions?
I move to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor to adjourn?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? No. Unanimous. Thank you.
Funding for Simsbury Community Television is provided in part by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.